just got a call, and this line is 873-1120 and 873-1121. And on the phones right now. Matter of fact, I just hit myself in the head with the phone, but I'm all right. Listen, Stella. Stella, are you out there?
Yes, I am.
And Stella, are you listening to the world's famous?
And you know that.
You listen to the world's famous Supreme Team?
You know it.
Stella, who is this that you're talking to, though?
C-Divine.
The mastermind?
That's right.
Oh, yeah.
You know it.
All right. Stella said we're the best show on the radio, y'all, so listen. So listen to this. Give us a call at 873-1120. We're going to go off tonight. We're going to go off. Justin, no homie.
No, don't do that.
I got to call.
Chill out.
Will a young lady call us? All men, stay off the phone. Stay off the phone. Let a young lady call us and tell us just how she feel. Or the crank caller. We haven't heard from you in a long time. Give us a call. Give us a call. Anybody, give us a call right now. You know the number. You know. Get up. Get up. Wake your mother and father up. Tell them to get up. We on the air. We's going off tonight, y'all.
Death Crew from the Bronx, checking out the Supreme
the
Team.
The Death Crew from the Bronx.
That's the Death Squad.
The Death Squad, checking out the Supreme Team, huh, Jeff?
Cheryl from Fort Greene.
Cheryl?
Would like to hear something. Let me come back again.
Oh, wow. Ladies and gentlemen of the world, we have another female on the phone.
What's her name?
She's on the line. Hold on for 1 minute. I press the button. What's your name, baby? And you say your name is Sherry?
Hey.
And Sherry, do you know who you're listening to?
Yes.
What?
C-Divine.
Sherry, please turn down your music, baby. Please. Just put it on tape. But you ought to turn your music that loud so the whole block can hear you right now. Because we get all that feedback and stuff. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So listen, Sherry, do you love the world's famous Supreme Team show?
This is my first time listening.
This is your first time?
All right. First time.
Well, baby, well, look, if you love the world's famous Supreme Team, here, you're talking just a lot of superstar.
Sure, do you love the Supreme Team show?
Yes, I do.
And what you like about the Supreme Team show?
The way y'all play y'all music, the way you talk. I like the way you talk, man.
And this is dedicated to you, Cheryl.
And this is Jayquan, and this is Foundation Lesson Number 47, the world's famous Supreme Team and Malcolm Mclaren. Now, I just had to let that rock first just to give you an example of what the world's famous Supreme Team show was all about with two things. To give you an example of what the world's famous Supreme Team radio show was all about, and then the magical marriage of what the world's famous Supreme Team did, and then the production of Trevor Horn and Malcolm Mclaren, and the magic that they made with just different snippets of sounds, different pieces from the radio show, and everything together. They made these magical records, but it all started at WHBI with the world's famous Supreme Team. Now, when you hear these clips and these excerpts and these sounds independent of being on the record, you can really, really appreciate, again, the magic of those records. So within this lesson, I will be injecting certain little pieces that were later used to make complete pieces. And this is the beauty of hip hop. You know, the beauty of hip hop has always been taking little snippets of things, little chunks of things, and then reworking them into something brand new and radical. And that's the essence of what hip hop is. And sonically, it's the essence of the magical and best parts of rap music. Now, first I'll give a brief history of the world's famous Supreme Team. Then I'll give a history of Malcolm Mclaren. Now, quite a few years back, Troy Smith did an interview on the Foundation, when we rock together on the Foundation, doing our interviews online. You go to foundationhiphop.com, click on interviews, and click on either it's under World's Famous Supreme Team or under C-Divine. C-Divine is spelled S-E with an accent mark over the E. It's under one of those, under interviews. And he did a very in-depth interview with C-Divine, and it was mostly about the early days of C-Divine's life and running Three Card Monty in Brooklyn and his hustle game on the streets. And he talked about some of the music as well. But it was a very in-depth interview, and you might want to check that out. It'll give you a real in-depth history of especially C-Divine, but the world's famous Supreme Team before records even happened. But you know, WHBI was basically, it was the station in New York that was, as far as rap music, it was a precursor to WBLS and other stations that started playing rap. You know, HBI was the place where you could just get a block of time, an hour, 2 hours, whatever, for a couple hundred dollars and just broadcast. Africa Islam had his Zulu Beat show on WHBI. Mr. Magic had his show. And right after Mr. Magic, the world's famous Supreme Team came on. Now, we're talking early part of the 80s, perhaps 82, 83, somewhere in this time with the world's famous. And the thing that made their show unique, you know, everybody's radio show at that time, you know, we're talking New York radio, early days of rap music, pre-Run DMC. These rap shows, a lot of it was like the personality of it. You know, remember the DJ, you know, you had the DJ that was the disc jockey that spun records and scratched and mixed on air, but you also had the radio personality. Now, at a time, you know, on BLS, it was Marley doing the engineering and the actual spinning and scratching, and it was Mr. Magic, rest in peace, as the actual radio personality. Now, on WHBI, with the world's famous, these guys were doing both. They were on the turntables, manning the turntables, cutting, mixing, but they were also great radio personalities. These guys had the radio voice. They actually put together a show. They produced the show. And a lot of their show was like what they call dedications. And if you listen to the intro that I did where I played a little bit of the world's famous Supreme Team on the air, interacting with the callers, they would have callers from all different parts of New York call in. And you would probably call it a shout out now. But they would have dedications where they would either take your name and just shout you out over the radio, or they have you call in and actually converse with them on the radio. And it was always interesting and good conversation. And I miss those days of radio where, you know, before corporate interest took over and you had these different playlists and, you know, you had to play the same record, you know, 3-4 times an hour. Back then, you know, it was a lot more creative. You know, you would hear the DJs either spinning breakbeats in the background or little snippets from records that were a lot of times obscure. You know, this is community-based radio. You know, you have people from the community calling in, the DJs interacting with them, taking requests over the air, but it was all put together in a format that was entertaining, and that was definitely the world's famous Supreme Team. If you get a chance to go to YouTube and do a search for WHBI, the world's famous Supreme Team, you can get a nice little glimpse of how radio was at that time and how organic it was. Now, C. Divine said that, you know, this WHBI, their signal was kind of weak, so it was always static. And he made a joke that, you know, if you turn the dial and you're trying to reach us and you hear some static, you got us. That's us, because the static is always there. But like I said, they would talk over, you know, different beats, you know, Billy Squire's big beat, you know, Mardi Gras, different break beats, instrumental pieces of rap records, you know, pieces of jazz records. And after a while, you know, the show got bigger and bigger, and they got sponsorship. People like the OJ, which was basically like the Uber of that day, the OJ car service, people like that would pay them, you know, to basically speak about them, sponsorship. So by this time, you know, 81, 82, rap music is hot. And, you know, these guys are making a name for themselves around the world. And enter Malcolm Mclaren. Now, Malcolm Mclaren, you know, he was a character of sorts, you know, and I mean that in a good way. You know, I don't have a lot bad to say. I don't have anything bad to say about Malcolm Mclaren. You know, Malcolm Mclaren has been said in retrospect to be a culture vulture. That's been said years ago before the word culture vulture was like an everyday term. You know, I've heard him called a culture vulture well over a decade ago. And rest in peace to Malcolm Mclaren as well. Before he even passed, I'd heard that term. But with Malcolm Mclaren, you know, he was a visual artist. He was a musician. He designed clothes. He owned boutiques. He was a performer. And, you know, he's most known for managing the Sex Pistols and the New York Dolls, those bands. That's what he's most known for. But he's kind of a jack of all trades, really. And, you know, C. Divine called him an opportunist, in which he was an opportunist. In the same way that, you know, hip-hop culture and music in the beginning, it was ripe for the picking. And what I mean by that was it was going to get exploited by someone at some point. Now, the word exploited can have negative or positive connotations. Usually when we say exploit, we put a negative connotation on it. But if you look at the etymology of the word exploitation, it has exploring. So anybody who delves into or explores something, they're exploiting it, period. Now, it might sound like I'm about to make an excuse for somebody, but I'm not. What I'm saying is any business people in the beginning who approached hip-hop, Sylvia Robinson, Bobby Robinson, Peter Brown, Tom Silverman, these are all executives that ran record labels that dealt with rap music, but these were people from outside of the culture of the music. Charlie Ahern, who was a director, Stephen Hager, who was a writer, who wrote the script, Perfect Beat that turned into Beat Street that he sold to Harry Belafonte. These were all people who were outside of the culture of hip hop, but they exploited it. Again, not in a negative way. They explored it. They looked at it. They said, how can this thing get bigger? Some of them did it just to bring out information and share this amazing thing that they came across with the world. Others said, hey, I could make money off of this. Now, you'll see some similarities, like Sylvia Robinson. When Sylvia Robinson first got into rap music, she was in trouble with her record label. She had five or six record labels, amongst them Turbo, All Platinum, Vibration, Stang. You know, she had quite a few record labels, and she was in big financial trouble. If you go back and listen to the song, her song, It's Great to Be the Queen, where she's actually rapping on there, she's rapping and saying that her whole future was on the line. And what she meant by that was she's about to go bankrupt and lose everything. And she strolls in the Harlem World, sees Love Buzz Starsky, rest in peace, rhyming on the mic. She got young sons that can hook her up with people into that world. And she said, okay, this is going to be my ticket to get out of my debt. And that's what she did. And I'm not mad at her for it, because she's directly the reason why the culture and the music even reached me. And people always say, well, if she didn't do it, somebody else would have done it. We don't know if they would have done it. The planets lined up for her. She had the right group with the right song and the right contacts to get the songs on the radio. You know, a lot of people say, well, Bobby Robinson, he had a more authentic, you know, stable of artists, blah, blah, blah. But what Bobby Robinson didn't have was the power to get his music on the radio and to the masses of people. And that's what Sylvia did have. So all of these people exploited the music, whether for financial gain or whatever it was, they exploited it. So here comes Malcolm Mclaren, who, according to C. Divine, was about $350,000 in debt to a company called Charisma Records. Now, Charisma is a UK-based label, and they're affiliated with Island and Virgin and a couple other labels. He was in debt, $350,000 plus, to Charisma, and it was his job to bring talent to the label, and he wasn't producing, and they were putting the heat to him, like, look, you know, what are you going to do? And just like rap music and hip-hop culture saved many people and made many people rich, many of them I just named, right in time for hip-hop to meet him, he comes here to the United States and he bumps heads or is introduced to people like Curtis Blow and Afrika Bambaataa. Afrika Bambaataa is or was an ambassador of sorts to many people. You know, he took people like Aaron Fuchs, you know, CEO and owner of Tough City Records, people who were outside of the hip hop culture, downtown people. He took them and showed them around, took them uptown and showed them this is what hip hop. He's a tour guide of sorts, and a just like Fab Five Freddy, he was a bridge and a translator to show these people who came from downtown, this is what we do, this is what we call it. You know, at one point they didn't even have a name for it. Somebody asked Bambaataa, well, what is it? He said, oh, we call it hip hop. You know, just off the top of his head, he pulled this together as an idea. So regardless of anything, we got to give Bambaataa the historical credit for the idea of all of these things that go on in these low-income neighborhoods amongst people of color. Him putting it together with a philosophy and a name, we got to give him credit for that. But Bambaataa would take people like that and show them this is what we do. And as he showed others, he showed it to Malcolm Mclaren. And Mclaren approached people like Curtis Blow and people like that, and nothing ever panned out. And somebody told him, look, you need to listen to WHBI, listen to these guys, the world's famous Supreme Team. You need to check these guys out. So according to C. Divine, of the world famous Supreme Team, this cat named Terry, who was a friend or an associate of Malcolm Mclaren, called into the station, set up the meeting between Malcolm Mclaren and the world famous Supreme Team. They got together over a meeting. They talked ideas. They talked, you know, money, contracts, preliminary things. C. Divine, the mastermind, and Just a Lot of Superstar, went over to the UK to record. And just like Jahlil of Houdini explained to me, that when they got to the UK, what they saw was like solid state boards, SSL boards, Fairlight samplers, and things that were not in the US yet. And that's again why those recordings sound so good, the Houdini recordings and the stuff that the world's famous did, because they were dealing with Fairlight samplers, SSL boards, and technology, digital technology that hadn't reached the States as of yet. So they begin to record, and the first thing that they record is Buffalo Gals, and it changed the whole face of the game. Man, such a piece of art. You know, this was 1982, so we're only a year after Adventures of Grandmaster Flash on the Wheels of Steel, which was the first record to contain scratching. And, you know, Adventures on the Wheels of Steel is one of the most important, if not the most important records. And I don't mean just early rap records. I mean, period. One of the most important early records of the genre. It's the record that, for those of us who weren't in the boroughs, or at least in the tri-states, it was the first time sonically the definition of what hip-hop sonically sound like was put on a record, and you could actually hear this is it. You know, if somebody can't describe it, put this record on and this is what it's about. And it was a patchwork of just different things from different places. You know, Flash took stuff off children's records, you know, spoken word pieces, disco records, funk records, and he mixed them all up. He cut and scratched them. Now, only a year later with Buffalo Gals, they took it to a level above what Flash did. When I say above, it doesn't mean that technically the craftsmanship and the scratching and cutting is executed better, but it's just more of everything. I mean, it's pieces from Square Dance, it's pieces from around the world, sounds from around the world. You know, that record was produced by Trevor Horn on a DMX drum machine. Now, C. Divine says that Trevor Horn, you know, was playing around on a drum machine and was asking C, you know, what kind of drum beat do you want? And C. Divine is trying to explain to him, I want this, you know, and it takes a while for Trevor Horn to tap out the pattern that C. Divine wants. And C. Divine said, well, look, let me do it. Let me show you. And Trevor Horn kind of doesn't let him do it. So, like, a couple hours go past, and they're not getting anywhere. And Trevor Horn says, well, you know, us white people don't have any rhythm, C. Divine. And C. Divine says, yeah, I'd heard that before, but now I actually see it. So they got some funny back and forth going on in the studio. But finally, they got that beat together on the drum machine. So C. Divine says his only contributions to that record were that drum beat and the scratching in it. Everything else was the brainchild of Malcolm Mclaren and the execution of Trevor Horn. Now, Trevor Horn is an interesting cat. You know, he's a producer, you know, UK-based cat, but, you know, he's behind Art of Noise, which is another, like, eclectic, you know. I used to read the back of record covers, like, that was my thing as a kid. I just stare at the back of record covers, looking at the credits, who did what familiar names, where was it mastered, things like that. And when I saw Trevor Horn on this record, when I first got this record, I knew that from then on, anything that had the name Trevor Horn on it, I had to get it. And the Art of Noise, which came not too long after this music with Beatbox and Close to the Edit and all their other legs and everything they did, always beat heavy. And they were actually sampling, again, with the Fairlight computer sampler. And I talk about the Fairlight on a lot of my lessons, but basically the Fairlight was a very expensive computer that could sample. Nobody was looping samples yet, but they were taking little pieces from various places, sometimes from records, and they were mixing them with this electronic music. And the Art of Noise, their whole thing was definitely just noises. They would put these different noises from various places into music and compose music based on literally noise. So if you go back and you listen to a song called Owner of a Lonely Heart by a group called Yes, and you listen to the breakdowns and the noise in there, you know, we didn't catch it as much back then. I think it's probably discussed more today of just how monumental pieces of that record are. And those pieces have been used over again in rap music, which is just the beauty of all of this. You know, how things are used and reused. You know, if you go back and check out I'll Take Your Man by Salt and Pepper, they use a piece of Owner of a Lonely Heart by Yes. And Trevor Horn was the person behind the production, all of that. You can Google him, you can YouTube him. He just did a new project and he just redid Owner of a Lonely Heart, and, you know, incredible producer. But I have to give props to Malcolm Mclaren. Culture Vulture or not, I have to look at the talent and the vision. And Malcolm Mclaren was a visionary. He used to walk around with a recorder and he would literally travel the world and record sounds, you know, Swahili land, you know, Harlem, you know, different parts of the world. He would record just sounds in nature, people, tribes, and he would put all this into the music. So, you know, one of the things that we do as DJs and producers and just inquisitive, curious people, we try to find out, well, where did that sound come from? What was that? And, you know, it still to this day, you know, almost 40 years later, I'm still trying to find out everything that was used in Buffalo Gals and everything that was on those EPs and albums that contain Buffalo Gals and Do You Like Scratching and World's Famous and all, you know, Hobo Scratch. Because even listening to Buffalo Gals, you know, when it comes in, you know, that's a chant, you know, that, you know, that's a human voice that he recorded. That's not something he took from a record. You know, a lot of the sounds in there and in all that music, you know, it was a that's why I said it took what Flash did to the next level. You know, the scratching that C. Divine did, the talking and rapping that they did on the songs, and just the different sounds, whether they were sounds in nature or sounds off the Fairlight. Like I said, a combination of C. Divine, Trevor Horn, and Malcolm Mclaren and his creativity and genius, it just, you know, the square dance pieces. It was an amazing patchwork that like I said, literally changed the game and changed the possibilities of what could be done musically.
Yeah.
So, of course, we could talk a long time about Buffalo Gals, Revolutionary, even something as simple as, you know, the vocal track being panned to one side, hard pan to one side, and the instrumental track being hard pan to the other. Now, again, when I talk, I always try to break things down for people who are not familiar with musical terms, because everybody here is not necessarily knows what panning something is. You know, when you record, generally, you record with everything in the center. You know, everything is equally on the left and right speaker, whether it's vocals, instrumentals, you know, instruments, vocals, whatever. And then, you know, for certain pieces, you might pan a little bit to the left or right. So when you listen to a song, you might hear, oh, you know, this background vocal, especially on headphones or something that's a little more condensed and closed in, it'll sound like a sound is more on the left or right. That's panning. You pan it to left or right. And, you know, you usually slightly pan. You know, you might want to put a sound effect or a vocal or whatever a little more on the left speaker than the right. It just gives the, sonically gives a certain flavor to the to your production. Well, this was the first time, or one of the first times, that a stereo song, this is not a mono song, a stereo song was mixed in that way where all the vocals were on one side and all the instruments were on the other. So when we heard it, it was great for us because we were in the middle of us experimenting with mixing and making pause tapes and things like that. So we would unplug one channel just to get just the beat, if we wanted just the beat or just the vocals. We could isolate it like that, almost like having like the multi-track to it, you know, back in 82. That was Revolutionary at the time. And C. Divine said he didn't think it would work, and he really was against it, but it was Malcolm McLaren's idea. And, you know, C. Divine said the way that clubs were set up at the time, he just said he didn't think it would work because the way the nightclubs are set up with the speakers and the acoustics and everything else, he didn't think it would work. Now, they do have versions that were not mixed like that. They have a regular versions where everything's in the center. But it actually worked, and that was great for us. That was a great time in music. The experimental things like that are what I miss in music, just the fact that people would just do shit like that just for the hell of it. Let's just pan all of this shit to this side, all the vocals over here and all the instruments over here. That just was, it was never done before this, you know, this great experimental time in music. And again, I'm still picking out sounds and you know, how did they do this? What is that? You know, what song are they, you know, picking this piece from? What, you know, what's the origin of this particular piece that we hear?
You're listening to the world's famous Supreme Team Show, WHBI 105.9 FM.
Chicago, by the name of Harvey, Andy, and Carizal. And they're some very good friends of mine. My name is Justin Lott of Superstar C.
And I have something here. The first call of the night goes by the name of Shakia from Soundview Projects. Kareem, Everlasting, Jayquan, Allah. And that's Rakim, Basha Allah from South Shore High School. They always make dedications with world's famous. Michelle from Bed-Stuy is checking us out. Dre B checking us out. Ace Ski from Brownsville.
Look it. break it down. We're on a world tour with Mr. Malcolm McLaren. We're going each and every place, including Spain, Asia, Africa, Tokyo, Mexico. He went to the places where the people told him not to go. So we're on a world tour with Mr. Malcolm McLaren. We're going each and every place, including Spain, Asia, Africa, Tokyo, Mexico. We went to the places where the people told us not to go. Some people said he is playing games. Some people said the man's insane. We're on a world tour with Mr. Malcolm McLaren. We're going each and every place, including Spain, Asia, Africa, Tokyo, Mexico. People say he went to the place where the people. We're on a world tour with Mr. Malcolm McLaren. We're going each and every place, including Spain. Some people say that the man. We're on a world tour with Mr. Malcolm McLaren. We're going each and every place, including Spain, Asia, Africa, Tokyo, Mexico. We went to the places where the people told him not to go. Some people said the man playing games. Some people said he's right insane. Some people say. We're on a world tour with Mr. Malcolm McLaren. We're going each and every place, including Spain, Asia, Africa, Tokyo, Mexico. We went to the places where the people told us not to go. Some people said he is playing games. Some people said the man's insane. We're on a world tour with Mr. Malcolm McLaren. We're going each and every place, including Spain, Asia, Africa, Tokyo, Mexico. People say he went to the place where the people.
Okay, so what I did there, I combined two songs that are really okay. There was She's Looking Like a Hobo, which was also on a 1982 12-inch with Buffalo Gals, one of the many 12-inches. There's so many versions of all of these songs, so many different EPs and alternative versions and alternate versions, I should say, imports and everything else. But on in 1982, there was Buffalo Gals, and then there was She's Looking Like a Hobo, which was basically the synthesized bass line, dun, 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 that really dope beat. And then there was Hobo Scratch, which was the same beat, but it was a lot of scratching, you know, interpolated into it. But the really, really dope part of that song, especially the longer version, is we on a world tour with Mr. Malcolm McLaren. We're going each and every place, including Spain, Asia, Africa, Tokyo, Mexico. We went to the places that the people told us not to go. Some people say that he's playing games. Some people say the man's insane. Now, what I loved about that, a couple things. Even in my youth, you know, hearing, now this is, again, this is Hobo Scratch. This is the scratch version of She's Looking Like a Hobo, which didn't drop till 83. And I believe that's Just Allah. That sounds like Just Allah's voice saying it. And it, you know what? I didn't even speak about the fact that the world famous Supreme Team were some of the first, if not the first, MCs dropping actual lessons from the 5% on records. You know, the golden age of rap in 87, 88, we had a lot of people. You know, I spoke on my Shan lesson about Shan being very early dropping mathematics when he said on Beat Bite, I got the knowledge to know, the wisdom to speak, the understanding of my rhyme is at its fullest peak, you know, the 1, 2, 3. But there were definitely sprinklings all throughout the radio show, definitely. But even on the songs, you know, Observe the First Law of Nature, Self-Preservation, and things like that. They were dropping science on the records very, very early in rap, earlier than anybody that I can remember. And their names, of course, you know, obviously they are a part of the Nation of Gods and Earths, the 5%. Again, Just Allah, the superstar, and C Divine, the mastermind. So, again, Just Allah, it sounded like him saying the way he made, you know, McLaren and Spain don't rhyme. But he said, hey, we're on a world tour with Mr. Malcolm McLaren. And he made it sound like McLaren and McLean. We go in each and every place, including Spain, Asia, Africa, Tokyo, Mexico. I like the cadence of that rhyme, and the fact that it sounded like he didn't even write anything down. He just was going. I'm not saying that he didn't, but he was going with the feeling of the song, you know. And even on that version I just played, you know, I don't know if he really messed up a few times or it sounded like he was trying to sound like he messed up. That's what it sounded more like. But either way, it put a nice little quality to that vocal. And Asia, Africa, Tokyo, Mexico went to places that the people told him not to go. And of course, later on when Tribe Called Quest did a war tour and they had De La Soul on the hook, and they said, we on a war tour with Muhammad, my man, going each and every place with the mic in our hand. And then, he does that in the same cadence. Clearly, they got that from World's Famous Supreme Team. I was a little disappointed because I never heard them say that publicly. I remember they were on BET. I'll never forget it. And they were asking what a war tour meant. And I remember it was Trugoy was breaking it down. And I just knew he would say, oh, we got that from World's Famous Supreme Team, but we just changed the words around. And he never said it. He went on to say this elaborate thing about, what they're going on a tour of all these psych wards or whatever, which was kind of out there. But they never mentioned World's Famous. And I hated that because I always felt like, even as long ago as that was, I felt like, those first generations, man, when people would borrow their sayings and their rhymes and their hooks, it was a whole generation of people that just didn't know, and they would think, oh man, that's brilliant. They said this, and listen to how they said it. And so many people that are familiar with Tribe and De La don't know who World Famous is and would never know that that's where it originated. But yeah, very, very dope. Everything about it, if you listen again, the Hobo Scratches, all kind of little dub parts in there and pieces run backwards, and everything about that was just so funky. And again, it's just Trevor Horn, Malcolm Mclaren, and World's Famous. And that song has been sampled and remade, as many of their songs have, so many times. And it's so dope. Even the part with the bomb, that part is used in Buffalo Gals, and it's used in other pieces of other songs. And they do that with a lot of their productions, a lot of their songs, pieces and vocal snippets from other songs are mixed in, like I said, just to perform perfection.
And we have on the line 1121, a female that goes by the name of what?
Little She.
And Little She, where are you from?
East New York, Brooklyn.
You're from East New York, Brooklyn. And what do you love about the World's Famous Supreme Team show?
All that scratch is making you itch? Well, Little She is making me itch too, I guarantee it.
I love it, though.
Here's just a lot of superstar. He has something that he wants to most definitely tell you.
Little She.
Yeah.
How long have you been listening to the World's Famous?
About 6 weeks.
6 weeks? Do you catch the 4 o'clock show as well?
You know that. All the shows, they come on late at night.
How do you manage to stay up 4 o'clock in the morning?
Who was that show right?
Scratching,
do you like
scratching?
What is it?
Sure, do you love the Supreme Team show?
Yes, I do.
And what you like about the Supreme Team show?
The way y'all play y'all music, the way you talk, I like the way you talk.
And Cheryl, may I ask you one more question?
Yeah.
Do you like scratching?
Scratching?
Yeah, what is it?
Scratching, scratching, scratching.
Scratching, scratching, scratching.
What is it?
What is it?
you know Chief Goodwill. We're on the air every Tuesday night from 1 to 2. Thursday from 4 to 5 and Sunday from 4 to 5. Chief Goodwill, let me know, do you listen to the 4 o'clock show?
No, but my daughter's
Yeah, do you like scratching? That was an incredible record. You know, one thing about that EP that had had Buffalo Gals, World's Famous, Do You Like Scratching, Hobo Scratch, She's Looking Like a Hobo. It was like 5 or 6 songs. I just wish it could have been longer because it was such a creative thing at that time. You know, again, dropping in 83. I don't even know if Run DMC had dropped quite yet. If they did, it was right around the same time. The impact had not been felt yet of Run DMC. So the stripped down sound that Run DMC brought in, it hadn't had a chance, if it even had dropped, it hadn't had a chance to really reverberate across the music. So what we had here was, this sound was really, for 82 and 83, it was kind of ahead of its time because we still had the Sugar Hill and Enjoy era of rap records. Were still, they weren't as powerful, but in 82, they were definitely still going strong. You know, this is the same year that the Message dropped. You know, we're not too far from, the big hits that Sugar Hill Gang had made, Apache and Ave Wonder. We're only a year apart from those. So those big four releases by bands were still relevant and still selling and still the defining sound of the music. So for them to hit us, you know, it's out of the blue with this this world famous and Malcolm Mclaren and Trevor Horn compilation of sorts was ahead of its time because it didn't have those elements of, you know, it wasn't a full band. It was very electronic with drum machines, a few synthesizers, and not much music. You know, it was no horn section. It was no bass, you know, and all the things that the Enjoy and Sugar Hill records that, you know, we were kind of by 82, 83, we were kind of tiring of that. It was time for something new, and that's why Run DMC was able to come in and be so effective with their sound because it was right on time. But something that, you know, kind of gets left in the dust or dropped in between the cracks was this sound. This was something that was, it was stripped down. It was not quite as stripped down because, of course, Run DMC had nothing but drums. But they came pretty close on here. You know, some synthesizers here and there, some pianos here and there, but definitely not the full band disco sound that we were still hearing from those previously mentioned labels. So Do You Like Scratching was just, it was incredible in that it was just, like I said, you know, a few, you know, a little synthesized bass line, few instruments, but it was basically just pieces from the radio show, vocal pieces manipulated, you know, for the hook of Do You Like Scratching, and then, you know, just amazing for the time. It was so groundbreaking. I used to really give this this EP a lot of play. I listened to it a lot, and it stood this test of time. I still enjoy playing everything on this EP. It was just really so far ahead of its time.
Now listen, this announcement that I'm about to make is very important. There is a female that lives out there in Oyster Bay, and that's out there in Long Island. A female that goes by the name of Cassie. For some reason, she has caught a case of amnesia. So if anybody from Oyster Bay or anywhere in that area knows Cassie, would you give her a call so she can find out a little something about herself? Check this out.
Baby, 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 baby All right, man, bring an organ. And you know I got to have that. Some people listen because they want a mystery. Some people listen, then say we're whack. But if they miss the show, they get the heart attack. Now look at you, you're sitting there, biting your lip. The whole world sees you as a hypocrite. Live out the first law and make yourself preservation. If the show doesn't help you, change the station. If you don't want peace in the world, love, peace, and happiness in an endless twirl. If all you want to do is keep the whole world back, you're the one that's whack. And we're world's, world's, world's famous.
Thank everybody. I'd like to thank all the engineers for making this record. I'd like to thank you for buying this record. But finally, I'd like to thank all the Buffalo girls out there. Huh. So until the next time, I say peace to you and everybody out there. Coming from the world famous Supreme Team with Mr. Malcolm Mclaren.
Hands down, not only one of my favorite Malcolm Mclaren and the world famous Supreme Team songs, probably my favorite, but also one of my favorite rap songs, period. And I mean, outside of the fact that they rap at the end, it might not be considered a rap song. I mean, it's their music was so hard to categorize, as it is with everything that Trevor Horn put his hands on. You know, the rhyme, you can hear and see Divine's voice when he's saying, you know, some people. What he said was that he wrote that in direct response to people criticizing them, you know, through WHBI. They would call the station and complain and say, you know, you guys ain't real MCs, you ain't real DJs, you're not really hip hop, you know, y'all are hustlers, you know, you guys used to run the three card, you know, Armani card game on people. And that was a response to the criticism when he's saying, you know, some people listen and say we're whack, but if you miss the show, you catch a heart attack. You know, calling them hypocrites and everything. That was a real emotion, what you hear in the end of that song. You know, that song has been sampled several times. Nas has used it. You know, plenty of MCs, especially in the 90s, sampled that. The music on it is beautiful. It's a very jazzy. The piano line in that, it's just incredible. And that was Ann Dudley on the pianos. You know, that UK team of people, again, the planets came together. You had the right people working in conjunction with each other to produce that beautiful music that they produced. You know, the thing is, as impactful as this music was around the world, especially in the UK, a lot of UK cats tell me, or have told me over the years, that the first taste of hip hop that they ever had culturally, sonically, was Buffalo Gals and world famous Supreme Team. But this music didn't do really well sales wise upon initially coming out, even though they had the power of like Island and Charisma behind them. What C. Divine said was that they were banking on MTV playing the video for Buffalo Gals, and just putting all of their energy and all their chips into that, all their eggs into that basket, so to speak. And MTV rejected the video when MTV saw it. You know, and they just didn't get it, and they rejected the video. And when that happened, it really messed it up for Island and Charisma. They didn't have a backup plan, and that kind of, you know, ruined them on the whole promotion of the record. And they never really pushed it like they could have. And as big as this record is impact wise again, sales wise initially, it didn't do what it was projected to do on a major label like Island is a big deal. You know, it's the home of Bob Marley and many other greats, and that whole conglomerate of labels that released, because this album was released on a few different labels, all affiliated with each other. It was a big conglomerate that released these, and it could have done a lot better for the power that it had behind it. But, you know, it just, rap was still new, it wasn't completely understood, and they just didn't execute it as well as they could have.
Man, I know this party ain't gonna be nuts, man. I'm gonna go and I'm gonna shoot up the house.
Man, what's wrong?
We've got to work together.
Come on, leave your guns home. Do you understand what I'm saying? You don't need it. You'll listen to the Supreme Team. Yeah, had a party one time myself up there at the Audubon Grand Ballroom.
New York City, don't. Let's just start again, start again. Hey, Ebo, Ebo next.
Yeah, so that was always a song that I really liked. That was Double Dutch, and that was Malcolm Mclaren, and the world famous Supreme Team was not involved in that particular song. And when C. Divine talked about that one, he said that's one thing that Malcolm Mclaren liked to do, was anything that was black from the States that wasn't known in the UK, he liked to take it over there. And again, I use the word exploit it. But I do believe, and I don't have any way of knowing, but I do believe that his interest and his passion for these cultural things was genuine. It's a fine line when we talk about these things. You know, I talk to people, you know, a lot about the fact that, and I think I mentioned it earlier here, the first hip hop movies, you know, Wild Style, Beat Street, they were produced by, you know, not only people from outside of the hip hop culture, they were produced by Caucasian people. And a lot of times when we do things culturally, especially in the low income environments that we come from, we don't recognize what we do as magic. So if, you know, or great, or even worth anything a lot of times, because it's second nature to us. You know, when Charlie Ahern passed by these black kids doing karate, originally when he did Wild Style, he saw black kids doing karate and playing break beats while they were playing outside, hopping around on mattresses, you know, kicking and doing karate. And that's when he started to ask them, you know, what they were doing. And that's when they introduced him to break beats and the culture of what was going on. And then later he met Busy B. When you're poor and so inventive and imaginative as we are, you don't necessarily see what you do as anything worth anything. So when somebody says, hey, can I film you? Sure, you know, you're just playing outside for us, you know, but to outsiders, it's like, wow, this is incredible. So I say all that to say, you know, I'm glad that people like Malcolm Mclaren took the time out to teach those outside of Harlem and outside of New York about the Ebonettes and the different Double Dutch crews, because otherwise we wouldn't have known. I mean, I remember McDonald's, they had a couple of television commercials with the girls doing a Double Dutch. And to me, Double Dutch, I always say, it comes out of the same spirit as the other elements of hip hop. There are things that were going on in these impoverished neighborhoods by people of color, primarily black people and brown people. These things were born out of necessity, the fact that we had to entertain ourselves. So we took two copies of an old record. We took the art that, you know, had been around for decades, the spray painting, you know, taking two copies of a record, continuously having the beat go, you know, speaking over the records. These are things that, you know, they say necessity is the mother of invention. These things were necessities. And that's what we always do. We always make lemonade out of lemons. You know, the slave master gave us the worst scraps and we made delicacies out of it. It's the will to continue to survive, and that's why we're still here and flourishing in any capacity. So as it is, like I said, with the Double Dutching, it's all, to me, out of the same spirit that any part of hip-hop culture derives from, double dutch and derives from that same spirit. So I'm glad that people like Malcolm Mclaren and people like Charlie Ahern and people like Stephen Hager, who are outside of the culture and are Caucasian people, I'm glad that they decided to exploit these different parts of urban culture in the way that they did, because if not, we tend to create and then move on. We don't have a good history of chronicling our history. So it's easy, you know, 30 years later to say that others took it from us. Many times they didn't necessarily take it from us. We willingly just left it. And somebody picked it up and said, hey, you know, this is a gem. Look at this. You know, they picked it up and dusted it off and said, this is a gem, when we didn't see it as a gem. So I like the vibe of the Double Dutch song. I like the imagery on the record cover. I wouldn't have known that the Evanettes existed if not for the refrain and the hook of this song and reading the lyrics on the back of the cover. And, you know, the whole campaign of sorts that Malcolm Mclaren, you know, put on to bring awareness to these things that were going on right under our noses in most cases. Now, winding it down, the world's famous Supreme Team also did something without Malcolm Mclaren. It was their biggest song ever. You know, they actually had a video, even though Buffalo Gals had a video, it didn't prominently display the world's famous Supreme Team in it. But officially, I mean, this is a video that played on, you know, Friday night videos and Night Tracks and all of the mainstream video shows back in 84, whatever year it was. They prominently played Hey DJ, and it became a song that got mainstream daytime radio play, which was still a big deal for rap records. Not many groups had those bragging rights that they had that daytime primetime airplay. And another interesting side note that I failed to mention earlier was that, you know, all these records, like I said, they didn't do as well as they could have done from a sales standpoint. But the way that those records were broke was, you know, C. Divine and Just Allah, they broke those records on WHBI because they didn't leave WHBI when the record started popping off. They were still on the radio. They would go tour England or tour wherever and, you know, go right back to HBI and hit the airwaves. And they broke Buffalo Gals and all those records on the radio. So by the time it was time to do Hey DJ, Charisma Records had merged with Virgin Records. So World Famous, you know, still had that connection to Charisma. And it was already proven that they could sell records. And this time they got behind the record, unlike they did with Buffalo Gals and those previous recordings. So Hey DJ was a huge record for World Famous. Definitely all this music has been remade and rehashed, some of it by other people, some of it by the players themselves. sometime in the early 90s, Malcolm Mclaren did like a part two to World Famous and updated Buffalo Gals, and he did a entire album. It had some a couple club songs on there, which actually did pretty well. Did some work with Grandmaster Caz on that album, and that was actually 1990. It was on Virgin Records, and it was called Malcolm Mclaren Presents the World Famous Supreme Team Around the Outside. Definitely worth checking out. It was very, very good album, I thought. You know, it had, like I said, a lot of dance music, a lot of house, you know, club type music. But at the same time, the revisits of some of those world famous Supreme Team tracks were very, very interesting, as is all their music. Hey, DJ has been remade and reinterpolated and reinterpreted several times. And all this is classic music, man, from a very, very innocent time before the music was commercially viable. And there was no need to try to go and make something that was going to be a concoction or formulaic. You know, everything was just made from the as cliche as it may sound, man, the whole thing was not about getting paid. It was about being as creative as you could. Like I spoke about panning the record left and right, you know, just doing stuff that was just so out of the ordinary, just to be different and just to push the envelope. And if the money came, the money came. But the money was always just a byproduct of just putting out good art. And again, rest in peace to Malcolm Mclaren. And definitely respect to Trevor Horn, Ann Dudley, World Famous, and everybody involved in those recordings. Definitely a great time period there. And this is Jayquan, and this has been Foundation Lesson 47. The world's famous Supreme Team and Malcolm Mclaren. Hope you found it entertaining, enlightening, and all that good stuff. If you'd like to contribute to the foundation, you can do so at patreon.com/JAYQUAN. If you need to reach me, you can reach me on all social media at JayquanVA, JAYQUANVA. And you can also donate via PayPal, and that email address is JayquanMusicVA@gmail.com for PayPal. Peace and respect.
Scratching Records, is it out today? Is that right?
Yeah, I think the record's come out today.
Okay, so we're in time. Now, I don't even know what scratching is. Well, I do, because you told me earlier, but viewers don't know what scratching is, so tell us all about it.
Well, let me explain to you that the idea is that you can take your favourite groove from any record you so choose in your own collection, be it a guitar riff or a little melody line from Kraftwerk or James Brown,
Beethoven,
or Keith Richards, or even a Beethoven melody, and find it on a record, right? And it might be 5 or 10 seconds or 20 seconds you like. And with that part, you can then mix that with a Keith Richards riff or a melody from Dionne Warwick or a particular James Brown drum beat. And you can start mixing the two together, and all you need is a drum box
to give you a constant
pulse. And then you can take a microphone and then you can holler over the top and make your own number ones. It's a bit like reconstructing the debris of all your old pop paraphernalia. It's, you know, seizing records from your brother's cupboard or your father's cupboard or your own records and making your own number one. What's exciting about it is the fact that you no longer need to go out and play guitars. You no longer need to go out and buy them. You can choose a friend up the road and you can put two decks together, and with a beatbox, you can start making your own records. It's making records out of records. And the term scratching comes from the fact that of moving the record backwards and forwards to scratch over. You're splitting up words, scratching over vocals, you know, and generally demoralizing the pop myth and beginning to find a way of using material yourself and not dealing with prepackaged pop product. And I like that very much. And the idea came to me from watching a group of kids in Harlem in the South Bronx who are actually mixing all kinds of records together and talking, singing, or hollering over the top. And then the floor broke loose and kids started to spin on their heads at the same time, or start to do robotic movements, letting an electric wave run through their arms and hit the other side of their fingertips. Yeah. And the whole thing there, they term hip-hop, scratching is part of DJing practice, and breaking is another form of gymnastic dancing, which you're about to see on a video that I made in New York celebrating this record.
And that's exactly what we're going to see immediately. Let's see that video now, which will demonstrate it even better. Now.